Good morning. We're so glad that you've come to join us for worship today. And if you're worshiping with us online this morning, we want to welcome you as well. We're glad that you're with us, and we wish we could be with you, but this is the next best thing. So welcome to worship into the presence of God, and I hope that you enjoy His presence this morning and get a glimpse of His holiness. Psalm 111 says, praise the Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord. I will praise the Lord with all my heart in the council of the upright and in the assembly. Great are the works of the Lord. They are pondered by all who delight in Him. Glorious and majestic are His deeds, and His righteousness endures forever. He has caused His wonders to be remembered. The Lord is gracious and compassionate. He provides food for those who fear Him. He remembers His covenant forever. He has shown His people the power of His works, giving them the lands of other nations. The works of His hands and are faithful and just. All His precepts are trustworthy. They are established forever and ever, enacted in faithfulness and uprightness. He provided redemption for His people. He ordained His covenant forever. Holy and awesome is His name. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All who follow His precepts have a good understanding, and to Him belongs eternal praise. Stand with us as we worship. A thousand generations falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb. And all who've gone before us and all who will believe sing the song of ages to the Lamb. Your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name stands above them all. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all. And the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever. If you've been forgiven, and if you've been redeemed, sing the song forever to the Lamb. And if you walk in freedom, and if you bear His name, sing the song forever to the Lamb. Sing the song forever to the Lamb. And the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever. Hear people sing, holy to the King of Kings, holy you will always be, holy, holy forever. Your name is the highest. Your name
is the greatest. Your name stands above the law. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all.
Jesus,
your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name stands above them all. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all.
And the angels cry,
holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever. Hear people sing, holy, to the King of peace, holy, you will always be. Falling down before.
blessed Trinity.
In Galatians, Paul writes, I say then, walk by the Spirit, and you will certainly not carry out the desire of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is against the Spirit, and the Spirit desires what is against the flesh. Those who are opposed, those two are opposed to each other, so that you don't do what you want. But if you're led by the Spirit, you're not under the law. Then Paul continues to list some things that are examples of works of the flesh, to which a multitude of things could be added to that list. And then he warns that those who practice such things, the works of the flesh, will not inherit the kingdom of God. But, he says, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. The law is not against such things. Now those who belong to Jesus Christ have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us keep on being in step with the Spirit. Step by step. We don't become perfect overnight. We're all sinners, saved by grace. And step by step, He leads us to be conformed to the image of Christ. Oh God, You are my God.
Oh God, You are my God, and I will ever praise You. Oh God, You are my God, and I will ever praise You. I will sing
change our hearts as we
Fresh touch. We want to hear from your word.
Right.
Speak to us. Open our hearts. Open our eyes. Lord, help us to see Jesus today. Help us to experience the presence of your Holy Spirit. Rain down your fire from heaven. Let us experience revival and renewal in our hearts. Touch our pastor today as he brings the word to us. Anoint his lips that the words that come through him will be directly from you. In your name we pray. Amen.
We have Children's Church available this morning for our pre-K through our first graders. Your leaders are meeting you there at the back. Church, if you'll turn with me to the book of Matthew once again. Book of Matthew, chapter 7. We're going to finish this section of sermons born out of the Sermon on the Mount. I know we didn't cover it all. That was never my intention, but several pieces of this as we get started on the new year and looking at how the Lord can speak to us and use us through this year. I hope I will remember to keep coming back to remind you that we are called to be salt and light, that it is our job to represent Christ well in the community, that we're to help take away the darkness, that we are to help season, that we are to help preserve, that we are to help do all the things that that means. And you probably heard more sermons on that than I've preached on it. But that's what we need to be. We need to find those places where we can touch others. Jesus, as he's preaching here on the Sermon on the Mount, has a lot of people gathered around to hear what he has to say. And he says a lot of different things. I think it was last week, we talked about being called to be holy and to set aside the things that would take us away from the Lord. But this was a serious calling. And there were the six things that he said, you've heard it said this, but I tell you this. And he took it from don't murder to don't even think bad thoughts. Don't commit adultery to don't even think the bad thoughts. To turn the other cheek. To care, go the extra mile. And Jesus is not saying the law is not important or doesn't give us direction, but he does tell us it doesn't save us. Paul read about that this morning. We got to make sure that we're being saved by grace and that we're doing the good things and we're not doing the bad things. That's what that Galatians verse was about. God wants us to do those things. And this morning, we're going to get back into connecting with the Lord here in Matthew chapter 7. And then following him in faithfulness. And so we're going to get two different parts to the message this morning. The first part is one you might be familiar with. Ask, seek, and knock. That's what we're told to do. So this is us recognizing a need and reaching out to the Lord. The next section is going to be about the narrow path and the wide path. As we seek the will of the Lord, we also need to look at our feet and make sure we're on the correct path. And if your path is level or downhill and there are no obstacles, I just want to say you might be on the wrong path. You might need to rethink that. You might not. God gives you seasons of refreshment. God gives you seasons of things going well and being a little easier. And you may just be in one of those seasons. But you also may be on the Indiana roads in the middle of winter where there are potholes and they come out of nowhere and they eat your car. You might be, as the 23rd Psalm tells us, in the valley of the shadow of death. You might be in some other difficult place. One of the things we need to be reminded of is we don't seek hardship to honor God. There are a lot of people that do that, and we need to avoid that. We don't need to make our lives look worse so that somebody will think better of us because we're handling it well. Life's plenty tough on its own. We don't need to borrow trouble from tomorrow or make up trouble for today. There's plenty of it out there. If you're in a good season, celebrate it and give God glory for it. But if you're in a troubled season, let's turn our hearts to the Lord. Join me in Matthew chapter 7. Starting in verse 7. Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. And the one who seeks finds. And the one who knocks, the door will be open. That seems really simple, doesn't it? Who among you, if his son asks him for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will give him a snake? If you then who are evil know how to do or how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good things to those who ask him? Therefore, what are therefores therefore? You got to ask yourself that. Because he's given us a pathway into his presence. Because he's given us a promise that we will receive that which we're searching for. That which we're seeking. Therefore, whatever you want others to do for you, do the same for them. For this is the law and the prophets. Jesus says, I didn't come to take away any of the law, but I fulfilled it. But now, so now we're not necessarily ignoring the things God has taught us from the Old Testament. We still need to know some of those things. But we're now doing the things that become natural to a transformed life. We're doing the things that become natural to a follower of Jesus. And we're avoiding the things that were natural before we became a follower of Jesus. And so we got to avoid those pitfalls. We just sang a song, Rain Down. Rain Down on Me. And I got to thinking about, you see them a lot in Israel. And if you hike in Brown County, you'll come across old homesteads that aren't there anymore. And you'll find cisterns. What was a cistern? History teacher. It's where they caught the water. So the runoff water, they would create channels and would go into this place where when it rained, the cistern would fill. And then during the drought seasons, you've got water. What is the limitation on the amount of water that you have? How big the cistern is. Jesus tells a parable about new wine and old wineskins, doesn't he? And the new wine has gases and it expands and it causes the wineskins to bust and you lose the product. So he says you put new wine in what? New wineskins, because it can handle, accommodate the blessing. Your blessing is limited by the size of your cistern. If you want God to rain down on you, you're only going to receive as much as you're capable of holding. But how long do you want to hold the water in a cistern? What happens if it sits too long? You can get contaminated, can't it? It's nice to have a little turnover every once in a while. I got a cat. I got two cats. They're not my cats, just for the record. I got stuck with two cats. The first one was Hannah's. It's a COVID cat. It's a really weird cat. It's strange. It was socially isolated for too long. Strange cat. The second cat, my wife came to me and said, Dad would really like a cat. Do you have a problem with Dad getting a cat? So Allison got a cat. And Lee didn't tell me that she was manipulating me. This little black and white cat gets up on my counter every morning when I try to shave. And she paces back and forth in front of me. And she wants me to put some water in the sink for her. Because the water in the bowl right next to that is not good enough for her. Even though I just filled it up. And since I'm her servant, I put a little water in the sink. You know, I'm getting ready to shave anyway, so it's all right. Probably got cat germs all up in my face from shaving with. But you know what the first thing that cat does? If you have cats, you probably know this. She stirs the water. She won't drink it until she has stirred it. We need to be moving some of that water around, those blessings that we've received, and sharing them with others. We need to make sure that we're receiving that which God intends us to have by equipping ourselves to receive it. And if you filled one 55-gallon drum of water, you know what? Get another one. We start receiving those blessings and start giving them away and see if God won't keep bringing them in. He tells us here a secret to connecting with him and receiving from him those things that we need. Those things that he desires us to have. Because what father will not give his son good gifts? So he has a desire to give us these things. But he's waiting for us to do our part. We've got to seek. It's the whole thing with salvation. Christ has offered everybody. It's a universal gift. Salvation through Jesus Christ, through the completed work of the cross, through the death, burial, and resurrection, where he defeated death and rose from the grave, and now sits in victory at the right hand of the Father. And he said, all who call upon my name will be saved. But what do you have to do? You got to call upon the name. There's always that peace in there. This is not a works-based salvation. Jesus did the work. But he requires us to want him. He's not going to force himself on us. We got to want him. So look what it says here in the ask, seek, knock. If you ask, what it's going to happen? It's going to be given to you. If you knock, it's going to be opened for you. If you seek, I left that one out, you're going to find. And then verse 8 kind of says it again. Who's everyone? Got any everyone in this room? All of us, everyone who asks, receives. And you say, well, I've been asking for a long time. Why don't I receive? This passage doesn't address it. But the rest of Scripture does. We can go other places. If you're not receiving and you're asking, what could be some of the problems? Number one problem is you. You're sinful. You're separated. You're selfish. Just like me. We don't get because we've not prepared the vessel to receive. The vessel is the temple of God. The Holy Spirit dwells inside of us. But we got to prepare the temple. When Moses was given the directions for the tabernacle, it didn't just happen. It had to be prepared. If you remember reading through the Exodus, who stood outside while Moses went into the tabernacle? Joshua did. And when Moses left, what did Joshua do? He went inside and fixed all the things Moses messed up. You know, he had to put the oil in, he had to trim the wick, he had to do all the things. We got to make sure that we're preparing to receive that which he desires to give us. And then we have to seek it out. We have to ask God for the blessings. But we need to ask it according to his will. Most of the time when we don't receive, it's because we're outside the will of God. But if we learn to pray according to his will, we'll find that he is going to do what he was already going to do to begin with. It's kind of like learning to redirect a child. Sometimes they're difficult and they get stuck on something. But if you can find something they're already interested in and redirect them to that, it's so much simpler than just fighting them. God wants us where he wants us, but he wants us to be holy. And so if we're asking according to his will, if we're asking according to his presence, we are likely to receive. In fact, we're promised here that we will receive. Everyone who asks will receive. Everyone who asks for salvation will receive. Everybody who asks for forgiveness will receive. We have to have a heart condition. We have to have a heart change. The one who knocks, the door is going to be open. We got a ring camera now. My dogs, I got two dogs. This is the animal sermon. They come to the door and they scratch the paint off of it. They knock. They let us know when they want in. The ring camera lets us know before they get to the door that they're coming. But we're lazy. And so we wait for them to knock. And you know, sometimes I don't feel like getting up off the couch because it's comfortable. I'm in the middle of my show, even though it's got pause right there. There's really no good excuse other than I'm lazy. I don't want to let the dog in. That requires me to take 15 steps. And I'm allergic to exercise. But what do my dogs do? They keep scratching until my wife says, "You're going to have to repaint the door if you don't go let them in." So I get up and I go let them in. Why? Because they're persistent. If they scratch long enough and I haven't let them in, you know what else they do? They bark. And after they scratched and barked, and if I don't let them in, what do? They get in trouble. They find things they know they're not supposed to do, even though they're dogs, and they do it anyway to punish us for being lazy. They eat, what is that flower thing? Hosta. It's just poisonous for dogs. It don't affect my dogs. They're all good. Well, they're just evil. But there's a great point in that. Jesus tells us we got to keep knocking. We got to keep asking. We got to keep seeking. And he's going to take care of us. But we need to do it according to his will for his glory. Remember, it's going to rain down. He's a good father. He wants to give us the good stuff. The blessings of life. That doesn't mean your life's going to be easy. We probably need to clarify what I mean by he's going to give us the blessings of life. It doesn't mean a new car and a new house and a big bank account. It means his presence, his holiness, his nature. One of the things I've learned just recently, because I've been teaching on it, studying on it, is we receive his righteousness. He gives us those things because we can't get there on our own. And he wants to continue to give those things that are most important and most valuable to us. We need to keep seeking. We need to keep asking. And we need to be like those dogs banging on the door and not giving up. Don't be like the dog who gets tired of waiting and goes and does bad stuff. Gets in trouble. Gets separated. Gets punished. Ends up locked in a kennel. Don't be that guy. God can do that too. Be the one who's there. God, I need you. I need you now. I need you. I'm not going to let go. What did Jacob do all night long with God? With a dislocated hip. He wrestled with God. And he didn't quit and he didn't give up. There was no quit in the guy. And in the morning, the angel of the Lord. By the way, who do you think the angel of the Lord was? I think it was Jesus. Blessed him. Gave him a new name. We got to be serious about wanting the things of God in our life. And we got to be preparing ourselves to receive the things of God in our life. That's, I think, what this is telling us he wants to do. Our good Father, if we ask for a fish, we'll get a fish, not a snake. And if we who in our flesh know how to do good things, how much more is God going to do for us who's perfect? And he calls us his children in this. He wants to do those good things for us. So we need to live in such a way that we have made ourselves available to receive his blessing. So let me ask you. Are you living in such a way that you're able to receive the blessing of God? That's what the rest of Scripture is for. It tells us the things. Paul read a passage out of Galatians. It tells us things we're not supposed to do. It tells us things we are supposed to do. We're preparing ourselves on both sides of that by adding things of holiness, fruit of the Spirit, and taking away things of sinfulness. And there's a lot of those. And as we do both of those, we become more like Jesus. We're preparing ourselves to receive his goodness, which is what he wants. When we receive his goodness, what do we do with it? There's two things minimum that we should do with it when we receive his goodness. What is it? It's not in this passage, but it's in the Scriptures, and you know the answer to this. We should praise God for it. We should recognize from where it comes. Jesus says, didn't I heal 10 men? Where's the other 9? We should come back and say thank you, and we should give him praise and glory for the good things he does in our lives. What else should we do with it? We should share it with others. We should share it with others. It's not to be hoarded. Remember in the calling of the apostles, we get two different illustrations of, first it was the brother that goes to get Peter. You need to come and meet this guy that is going to change your world. And then the other one was Nathaniel. You need to come and meet this guy who's going to change your world. Go to the Samaritan on the hilltop and Jesus meets her in the midst of her sinfulness and tells her everything that she has done. And she believes that he is the Lord, the Messiah. And what does she do? She goes and tells. She shares the good news. He gave me living water. I don't have to go to the hilltop anymore. No, you still got to drink. But now you got something that will never leave you, that will refresh you spiritually. Living water. We've got to receive, and when we receive, we got to praise and we got to share that good stuff he's doing. He says, verse 12, whatever you want others to do for you, do the same for them. So if you're begging God for peace in your life, what do you need to do? You need to give the forgiveness that's going to bring peace to somebody else. Because God's going to give you the forgiveness you need to bring peace into your life. When you need a family member restored to you and you're praying for that, you know what you need to be doing? You need to be helping somebody else pray through their need to have a family member restored to them. We don't do this life alone. We need to do others that which we're seeking for ourselves. We need to make sure that we're giving the same good gifts that we're getting and we're asking and we're seeking. We need to make sure that we're doing that sharing part, that giving away as we receive. Can you ever give away more blessings than God has given you? You can't. You can't keep up when it becomes a giving competition with God. He can outgive you every single time. We need to be busy about his business. Look at the Apostle Paul throughout his life and all the suffering that he went through as he served others. And he would probably, if he were here today, say, I received the greatest blessing of all. I got to meet Jesus. And if we've met Jesus, we need to share that blessing with others. And as he blesses our lives, we need to make sure that we are blessing others. I want to go to the second part of this passage. These are together. I was reminded in going through scripture recently. It's actually in the book of Romans that we're doing on Wednesday night. But I was reminded that we often read and study the Bible in segments. We read a verse, a passage, a chapter. And if you're a really good pastor or teacher, you get a word, right? And they only teach one word the whole time and you don't understand nothing that the person's talking about. Some of us do those things. But most of the Bible are letters. When you read a letter, do you just take one line out and just, that's the only line you ever read? Now, it might be if that's the line where your husband said, I love you, and it's the last and only time he's ever said that to you. You know the story about the couple that got married, and the wife, after all these years, says, why don't you tell me you love me? He says, I told you the day we got married and it hadn't changed. Guys, Valentine's Day is coming up. That's not good enough. We need to make sure that we're doing the right things and we're coming back to it and we're making sure that others see it and know it and understand it. And so the second part is making sure that as we're asking, as we're seeking, as we're knocking, as we're receiving the gifts of God, as we're prepared to share those and give God glory for them, that we're staying on the right road. It's easy to get off when you get blessed. It's easy to get what we've been seeking and what we've been after and forget about the God who gave it to us. It's easy to not be appreciative. And he puts these two together. So oftentimes it's letters, and we need to read the letters as such. We need to read what's before. We need to read what's after. We need to read it in its completion and kind of understand the progression. And here in Jesus' greatest sermon in Scripture, there's a progression. And he goes from asking, seeking, and knocking, and receiving, finding, and having the door opened to making sure we're on the right path. So he tells us to do to others that which we want done to us. And then in verse 13, let's read this next section through 23. He says, enter through the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the road is broad that leads to destruction. And there are many who go through it. Narrow is the gate and difficult is the road that leads to life, and few find it. Be on your guard against false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are raging wolves. You'll recognize them by their fruit. Are grapes gathered from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? In the same way, every good tree produces good fruit, but a bad tree produces bad fruit. A good tree can't produce bad fruit, neither can a bad tree produce good fruit. Every tree that doesn't produce good fruit is cut down, thrown into the fire, so you'll recognize them by their fruit. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father in heaven. On that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, didn't we prophesy in your name and drive out demons in your name and do many miracles in your name? Then I will announce to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you lawbreakers. The end of this chapter deals with two foundations. I preached that last year and we talked about building up our foundation. But I want to talk about this narrow road that we're supposed to be on. It's not a hidden road. I think sometimes we give the wrong impression. It's a narrow road. It's a road that will protect us. It's a road that will guide us. It's a road that will allow us to experience all the things God intends us to have in this life, so that we can be made holy as he is holy, so that we can be purified to become more like him. This is the road that has all the things on it that we need. Now, Satan has prepared parallel roads and perpendicular roads and this roads and that roads. Remember the Cheshire Cat, Alice in Wonderland? Which way do you want to go? Well, I don't know where I'm going. I don't know the exact quote. What's the cat say to him? What's the cat's response? If you don't know where you're going, it doesn't matter which way you go. If you're not following Jesus, you're on the wrong road. And it's going to end in the same place. Every road but one ends up in hell. But one road ends up in heaven. It's a narrow road. And that's the one that we're told to get on. God's not hiding that road from us. He's making it very clear to us. And he's given it to us through Scripture. Jesus was there in the flesh. He says, enter through the narrow gate. Enter through the narrow gate. He says it's difficult, but it leads to life. This is the part that should trouble you. If you want to lose some sleep, and few find it. If you find it. I don't know what that means. I can't put a number to few. But I know this, there's a lot of people out there who claim Jesus who don't live like Scripture. And I'm chief among sinners. And I recognize that. And I know that. And yes, I'm a hypocrite. But I'm trying to be more like Jesus every day. And I know some of you feel the same way. I think most of you feel the same way. That's the difference. There are a lot of people who claim the name of Jesus, will tell you they're a Christian, but they're not trying to change. They're not trying to grow in their faith. They're not trying to adapt to a new way of life. But rather what they're doing is they're adding Jesus to all the things they already did. And they're not taking anything away. And that's not scriptural. That's a wide road where you just add one more thing and you don't take anything away. And I think a lot of us need to evaluate our lives and ask ourselves, how am I different from the day that I met Jesus? And if you're not, I'm not telling you you're not saved. That's between you and the Lord. I'm telling you, you need to evaluate. Was I saved? Or am I not saved? If I was saved and I'm not living in obedience, how do I get back to obedience? Get back on the narrow road. If I wasn't saved, I need to get saved so I can get on the narrow road. But either way, we need to get out of the weeds. We're going to be gone. Alice and I and Hannah and Rustin are going to Ecuador March 2nd through the 8th. Jim Shields is going to be here to preach. He's the camp director at Highland Lakes. He'll preach two Sundays there. I serve him with Jim down at Highland Lakes. He asked me to do a course, a hiking thing with the kids one year. And so I took him down into an area that I didn't realize because I hadn't been in that area before that was full of stinging nettle in the summer with kids in shorts. It was a very wise decision on my part to take him somewhere where I didn't know what it was going to be like. You know what happened? We left the path because there was a hiking path. I don't like hiking paths a lot of times because they're no fun. That's the path everybody else goes on. So I try to create my own little trail or find a little animal trail and follow it. Sometimes when you get off the path you're supposed to be on, bad things happen. And you itch. You itch a lot longer than the hike. And when you tell people, they don't give you a hug and pat you on the back. What do? They point and laugh. And they tell you how stupid you were to do that. And why weren't you thinking better? And really all you need is a little ointment. A little hand up. And a little humility will go a long way to realizing we don't have it all figured out. But if we get back on the path, we can get where we're going. With less obstacles. With less backstepping. We need to make sure that we're following where God would have us go. He tells us the narrow road is difficult, but it leads to life. And we need to get on that road and we need to follow it. He tells us to be on guard against those who would get us off the road. Those who would take us to a wide road. We need to be making sure that as we're asking, as we're seeking, as we're knocking, that we're doing it on the narrow road. These two concepts go together. We're doing it in the will of God, not for our own benefit. We're doing it in the will of God, not for our glory, but for His glory. We're not asking what's best for me, but God, what is best for your kingdom? When Jesus teaches us to pray, He says, "Your kingdom come." Jesus says to God the Father, Jesus who is God says to God the Father, "Your kingdom come, your will be done." And when Jesus is in the garden, what's He say? "Father, not my will, but your will be done." If you want to ask, seek, and knock, you got to get on that narrow path that is about the will of God. It's about the glory of God. It's about the goodness of God. We need to make sure we're doing it right. We need to avoid the false prophets who'll get us off that. Avoid the thorn bushes and the thigs. Understand that if you're walking where God is, you're going to produce good fruit. If you're not walking where God is, you're not going to produce good fruit. You'll produce bad fruit. And you'll be known by your fruit. you don't understand the fruit reference, you have to ask Eric Ott after church. He raises apple trees. He knows all about those things. You got to produce the good fruit, which means what do you have, Eric, to produce good fruit? Good trees. Where do good trees start? Rootstock. I've learned something from Eric over the years. I know very little about biology and all that kind of stuff, but rootstock matters. Who's our rootstock? If we're rooted in Christ, we got good stock. We got good beginnings, and we can build from there. And we'll produce better than if we try to do it on our own. And then verse 21 is the warning. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. There's a lot of those out there who are doing things their way and adding the name of Jesus to it. Doing things for their glory and adding the name of Jesus to it. And there's a warning here. What's Jesus going to say to those people? I never knew you. What does it take to be known by God? It's a heart change. It's a heart condition. Remember when we ask, seek, and knock, we have a responsibility to take a movement toward Him. He's already made His movement toward us. He gave us Jesus. He gave us the prophets. He gave us the scriptures. He's given the Holy Spirit into the world around us. Scripture says we can't even come to Him unless He calls us. So there's a calling that's universal to all people to come to Christ. But there's specific calling where God says, I want you to be my child. But He's waiting for us to pick up the phone. He's waiting for us to invite Him in. He's waiting for us to recognize we can't do it on our own. What's it take to become a child of God? Father, I'm a sinner. We have to recognize our separation. If we don't have sin, if we don't recognize sin and sin that separates us from God's eternity, then we don't need God. But the reality is we're all sinners. That's what Scripture tells us. So we've all been separated from God. So what do we need? We need a way to get rid of our sin. God knew that. He understood that. The law points us toward our sin, but the Savior takes us out of our sin. It says that God sent His only begotten Son, Jesus, to die in place of us, because the penalty of sin is death. So Jesus took that death upon Himself. Yes, He really died. He was buried, and He rose again. He's alive. He overcame death. And in His resurrection now, He's offered us that gift of life that only He can give. But we need to receive it. We start by recognizing we don't earn it. We don't deserve it. We can't do it on our own. And we need our sins forgiven. We recognize the power and the person of Jesus Christ is given to us through Scripture. The Son of God. Who lived, died, and rose again. And we receive Him. We say, I will give you my life, my sin, my burdens, my separation. And I receive the life you desire me to have. Your free gift of eternal life in heaven. And Scripture says that we are spiritually reborn. We are not just renewed, but we are reborn. We are transformed. The old is gone and the new has come. And that we can never go back to what we once were. So how do we receive that blessing of God and get on the narrow path? It's in the name of Jesus. For there is no other name under heaven or earth by which men have been given in which to be saved. But only in the name of Jesus. And name means character, nature, the inner man. It's in the person of Jesus that salvation comes. If you want to receive, you got to ask. If you want to find, you got to seek. If you want God to open the door to the heavenly world, you got to knock. You got to get on that narrow road and stay there. Even though it may be difficult along the way, the blessing comes through the midst of the difficulties. Because His Spirit is with you and He will never leave you or forsake you. But it comes in asking and it comes in connecting. How much blessing are you going to receive from God? All that you're prepared to handle. How big's your cistern? Are you using an old wineskin for new wine? You're going to burst and you're going to leak more than you keep. God tells us we got to be changed and transformed and renewed. and follow him. Okay, get rid of the old. Cut out those things that don't work. Add the new. The fruit of the Spirit, the gifts of God, the glory of God, the presence of God, the righteousness of God. And why do we do it? For his glory, not ours. It's about his kingdom. This morning as I talk to you, have you made that commitment to Jesus? Are you living your life for him? Are you walking with him? Have you received his gift of eternal life? If not, he's offering it to you. Not because I'm speaking, but because he loves you directly. And he wants you to have those good gifts of a father to a child. And he's just simply waiting on you to say, Lord, I need you. I need you to forgive my sins. I need you to come into my life. And I commit to follow you. That's what lordship is. We make Jesus Lord. I commit to follow you all the days of my life. If you're willing to do that, the scripture says that you will be saved. It's a guaranteed gift if you're willing. Are you willing? Church, if you're in Christ Jesus, have you got to the side of the path? Have you stepped off the path? Have you taken one of those intersecting roads, one of those parallel roads? Consider getting back on the path. 1 John 1:9. If you'll confess your sins, he's faithful and just to forgive you and to cleanse you of all unrighteousness. As we close up this morning, where do you stand as you stand before God? And how do you get to where you would want to be? Let's pray together. Father, I thank you this morning for our time together. I thank you for your word that takes us down a pathway of righteousness for your name's sake. I thank you for the things we've been able to cover, but for the things we haven't covered. Like if we seek first your kingdom and your righteousness, all these other things will be given unto us. It's starting in the right place, starting in seeking you, Lord. Help us to find you. Help us to ask for your love, for your mercy, for your comfort, for your peace. Help us to ask for opportunities to share the good news of Christ with others. Help us to seek your presence so that we can be in your presence as we worship you, as we respond to you, as we live out each day. Help us to knock with persistence, asking for your blessing, preparing the house so that we can receive the blessing, and sharing the blessing with others as we come, as we go, as we walk along the road, as we lie down, as we get up. Father, help us today to find Jesus, to be restored to Jesus, to honor you with our lives. Help us to get on that narrow path and to stay there, to avoid the hardships of the wide path, to go through that narrow gate that only few will find. Lord, I don't know who those few are, but I thank you that when I was 8 years old, you brought me through that gate. And I thank you for every life that's been touched that way before and since. And I ask today that that gate would be open to those who are willing to ask. Give us the courage to do so. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Church, will you stand with me? We're going to sing. As we sing, we say we open the altars. I'll be here at the front to receive you. If God is working in your life and you need to ask a question, you need to talk to me about something, if you just need to come up and say, Pastor, can we talk after service? You can do that. I'll be available after service. You can find me there. But my desire would be that if God's working in your life, you'll share that with us so that we can give him glory for it, so that we can share together in the goodness of God. What decision do you need to make? If God's speaking to you, won't you come? Let's sing. I'll be down here to receive you as you respond.
We walk with the Lord in the light of his word. What a glory he sheds on our way. While we do his good will, he abides with us still, and we'll all who trust and obey. Trust and obey, for the
nights of His love, until all on the altar we lay. For the favor He shows, and the joy He bestows, are for them who will trust and obey. Then in fellowship sweet, we will sit at His feet, or we'll walk by His side in the way. What He says we will do, where He sends we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
Amen. Please be seated. Thank you for your attention this morning, your participation with us as we worship the Lord together. A couple of announcements. We still have these half sheets. We give these out each week. If you haven't got one, they're usually available at the sanctuary door. Jim might have a few left. He's out of them. They're downstairs by the front door on the left. They've got our announcements on them. At the very bottom of this page, it says Thursday, ladies, Bible study at 7 p.m. That is on Tuesday. It's on the wrong line. So just note that, ladies. That's Tuesday, not Thursday. And it's not too late to sign up. You can be a part of that. And so that's the mix-up we got. Got it on the wrong line. 7 p.m. Only 7 p.m. It's not a morning session. They talked about doing two sessions. They're only doing one session. It is at 7. Tonight, we have something special at 6 o'clock for those who declare themselves to be senior adults. The CIA, I'm trying to think here. The CIA children, it's on the screen. I should have read it. CIA children are fixing you supper. They're going to serve you. And they're going to talk to you about all the things God's doing in their lives. And so we want to encourage you to come back and be a blessing to these kids as they bless you with a meal. For those of us, and I was told I was not a senior and I don't get to come. For those of us who yet to qualify for a free meal at church, we'll be up here in the sanctuary. You'll be with me, so I look forward to having you tonight. We do have a youth group also. You'll be with Allison. The kids will all be together working on the meal and with the leaders who will be helping them to do that. So come back tonight. We look forward to having you. Regular Wednesday night services at 6:30. You're always invited to be a part of that. Are there any other announcements I need to give you this morning? Those are the main ones that I can think of. We have deacons meeting this afternoon. This one's not in the bulletin because I haven't told Carla about it yet. The second Sunday in February, I don't know the number. Second Sunday in February, I'm going to be starting a new members course, or we call it Discovering Calvary. It can be for existing members who just want to learn more about our church, or it can be for new people. I'm going to be doing this during the Sunday school hour. It will be 3 weeks in a row during the Sunday school hour. We'll meet together and talk about the things of Calvary. What makes us who we are? What does it mean to be a member of Calvary? How do I do that? That's starting the second week in February, the 11th. Thank you. February 11th. Just notate that. If you're interested or want more information on that, see me. I'll be glad to share that with you. If you're new to us, new with us, we'd love to meet you, get to know you better, and be able to share the things that excite us about what God's doing here at Calvary. Any others? All right. Prayer requests. I don't have anything new, I don't think, that I'm aware of. So continuation from Melvin Wells at Morristown Manor. I know we still have a lot of other people on the prayer list and other sicknesses. Anything pressing we need to share with the congregation this morning in terms of prayer? Deacons meet this afternoon. We'll be talking about a new deacon ballot for the church to renew or to add some new deacons for this year. And so we'll get that information to you after we discuss it this afternoon, next week probably. Buddy? All right. It's a lot of flooding, not just in Maine, but that is one place. Lots of flooding in several places. We had a great worship conference this weekend. We had 9 of our adult leaders, including myself. By the way, it was affirmed the pastor's actually a worship leader, even though he doesn't sing or sing well. I do sing. I just don't sing well. It was a great conference. We'll talk to you a little bit more about that next week, and maybe we'll get together and talk about some of the takeaways that we got from this. And I just want you to know that those of you who invest in opportunities like that for training so we can do those kinds of things, it was worthwhile. There were several of us doing some new old things again because we were reminded of things we know we're supposed to do that we've gotten out of the habit of doing. And so just it was good. And we had 4 teenagers go. I think Audrey's the only one. Is Andrew in here? Andrew's not in here. Audrey's the only one with us this morning. And I know she had a great weekend. If you have the opportunity, just ask her, what did you learn from the Lord this weekend? How did God bless you? And I'm sure she'd love any of us. The Larimores, the Georges, the Gordons, Allison and I, and Eric Metz, we thank you for sending us and letting us go be a part of that. It was a good weekend. That's all I have, I think, in terms of announcements and such. I'm going to turn it over to Paul and let him close us out. I'll greet you by the front door as you go.
Well, one thing that came to my attention this week is our Facebook people that joined with us. They're part of our group, too, our family. And one of the things I'm going to do as we continue on, I'm going to monitor our Facebook feed live while the service is going on once I get done with my part.
He's not playing the dots games.
And if you happen to be ill and watching from home or out of town, like the Spanglers are away from, but they were watching with us this morning.
Praise the Lord.
And so I know that some of them are not feeling well. Well, Melvin's in the nursing home. Sue's with him. And we want to remember them in prayer. And I would encourage you, those folks that are here with us, just turn the volume down so it doesn't interrupt the service, but just monitor and see who's on.
I would encourage you to monitor after the service.
I'm encouraging those folks to mention prayer requests.
Amen.
And let us know what their needs are so we can, at this point in the service, pray for them as well and include them in what we do. So
Let me add to that. We had a serious request last week that we took off of the rise. Some of you may have seen that before we did, but it was addressed. People let me know after the service that there was a serious need that was put on there, and it was addressed. And Lord does work in those lives and through those processes. And I don't see the things live that they're happening, but I appreciate that Paul's going to be looking at those. So keep us informed. Let us know.
And
we'll miss you the best we can.
People who join us anonymously who are wondering if this is a place for them to visit. And we're grateful for them as well and hope that they were blessed today as they tuned in with us in worship. So let's pray together, and we'll be dismissed. Lord, thank you for your word today to us. We want to trust you and obey what you tell us to do. We also want to encourage one another and build each other up. So help us be mindful of who needs a word of encouragement this week and to share with you with them the bounteous grace of our God. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.